Yes, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Today's drug for discussion is ethosuximide. So before going to the topic proper, we'll have a few questions so that we'll get the answers at the end of the session. So question number one is, all of the following are true of ethosuximide except can be used in atypical absence seizures. Option B, can be combined with other antiepileptics in refractory absence seizures. Option C, can be safely used in typical absence seizures in children of all ages. D, side effect profile is better compared to other drugs used in absence seizures. So this is question number one. We'll see the answer at the end of the session. Second question, a 7-year child has typical absence seizures for which ethosuximide 200 mg BD was prescribed and the dosing schedule was morning 9 a.m. and night 8 p.m. And at 6:30 p.m. the parents realized that morning dose was skipped. What is the next best plan? A, take both doses together at 8 p.m. B, take one dose at 8 p.m. C, take forgotten dose immediately and second dose at 8 p.m. And D, take both doses immediately. So this is question number two. Then again, answer will at the end of the session we'll discuss. So coming to the topic proper, ethosuximide will divide the topic into following headings: introduction, drug chemistry, dosing, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics, indications and contraindications, adverse reactions, its use in hepatic and renal dysfunction, use in special population, and overdose of the drug. Coming to introduction, it is succinamide. It is an anticonvulsant and it is the drug of choice in the monotherapy or combination therapy of children with generalized absence epilepsy. It is chemically designated as alpha ethyl alpha methyl succinamide, and the anti-epileptic effect of the drug is attributed to the ring nitrogen. The nitrogen is present between the two oxygen atoms, so the anticonvulsant effect of the drug is attributed to the ring nitrogen. So how the drug is supplied? It is clinically available for oral administration in the form of syrup or capsules. A capsule contains 200 mg of ethosuximide. It also contains polyethylene glycol, gelatin, glycerin and sorbitol. And it should be stored at 25 degrees Celsius and the exertions permitted are 15 to 30 degrees Celsius. The contents like polyethylene glycol, gelatin and glycerin sorbitol can sometimes cause anaphylactic reaction in a patient who has got hypersensitivity. Coming to the syrup, it is available as 200 mg per 5 ml. It should be stored at temperature not exceeding 30 degrees Celsius. Do not freeze and it should be protected from light. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, absorption, it is almost completely absorbed and syrup form is better absorbed and at a faster rate compared to the capsule. As it is rapidly absorbed, its bioavailability is 95 to 100%. Volume of distribution is 0.7 liter per kg and the levels in cerebrospinal fluid, saliva or tears are similar to those in plasma. It is not bound to plasma protein. Hence, this can be dialyzed in case of overdose. As it is not bound to plasma proteins, this is dialyzable. It follows the linear kinetics. The plasma levels of the drug increases in proportion to increasing doses. And 7 to 12 days are required to reach steady state plasma levels. So this is important, as we should not, once the drug is started, we should at least wait 4 to 7 days so that the effect of the drug comes that is that to reach the steady state plasma levels, then only the another hike in dose should be done. Coming to metabolism, 80% of ethosuximide undergoes hepatic metabolism and primarily by cytochrome P450 isoenzymes, and the major contribution coming from cytochrome 3A and to lesser extent from cytochrome 2E and 2C and B. So this has implications as enzyme inducing drugs can cause metabolism of ethosuximide and causing decreased levels of plasma. And it is 20% is excreted unchanged in the urine. The peak plasma concentration is reached in 3 to 5 hours and it is shorter for syrup. The half-life of a drug is 30 to 40 hours in children and 50 to 60 hours in adults. Coming to the indications, it is FDA approved for absence seizures above 3 years of age. Off-label, it is used as a combination therapy for other forms of epilepsies coexisting with absence seizures. Also, it has been used in neuropathic pain. So FDA's approval is only for absence seizures above 3 years of age. So coming to absence seizures, so absence seizures are brief seizures characterized by a behavioral arrest. So this can be seen in genetic generalized epilepsies like childhood absence epilepsy, juvenile absence epilepsy, juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. So atypical, there's something called typical absence seizures and atypical absence seizures that will come in next few slides. Atypical absence seizures have been reported in up to 60% of patients with Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. So genetic generalized epilepsy, these are the genetic generalized epilepsies, are childhood absence, juvenile absence and juvenile myoclonic epilepsies. So coming to semiology of absence seizures, there will be brief spells in which the patient has a loss of awareness, is unresponsive and has a behavioral arrest. The episodes frequently occur, often more than 10 throughout the day, and most children stop their activity completely and some can continue the activity more slowly. And some children have 3 hertz regular eyelid fluttering, and sometimes oral automatism can also occur, especially with prolonged seizures or during hyperventilation. Pallor is also reported, but urinary incontinence is rare. And one should note that this type of seizures are not preceded by an aura and do not have a postictal state. So this is an EEG of a typical absence. So typical absence means, so there should be bilaterally synchronous symmetrical 3 hertz spike and wave discharges. And it should start and end abruptly. And the most important thing is the background should be normal. So this is the definition of typical absence seizures. So bilaterally synchronous symmetrical 3 hertz spike and wave discharges. It should start and end abruptly. And background should be normal. These are found in genetic absence epilepsies, what was mentioned earlier. Coming to the atypical absence, which is found in Lennox-Gastaut syndrome, these seizures are more, the discharges are more insidious onset and offset, and slower spike and wave paroxysms less than 3 hertz, generally 2.5 hertz, and an abnormal interictal background. So this is atypical absence. So coming to the origin of the absence seizures, there are mechanisms how the absence seizures form. So this is a basic circuit for that. This is called corticothalamic circuit. So what this contains, basically 3 types of neurons. First is the cortical neurons in layer 6. And the second is the reticular nucleus of thalamus. And third is relay neurons in thalamus. So as we know that the cortex has 6 layers. So what are the layers of cortex? One is from superficial to deep. First is a molecular layer. Second is the external granular layer. Third is external pyramidal layer. Fourth is internal granular layer. Fifth is internal pyramidal layer. And the sixth layer is multiform layer. So the cortical neurons in layer 6, that is the multiform layer, are involved in the generation of absence seizures. So next, it sends excitatory discharges to the reticular nucleus of thalamus. So reticular nucleus of thalamus, basically it is a thin layer of nerve cells, and it lies between external medullary lamina, which is the lateral part of the thalamus, is a part of white matter, and it is present between external medullary lamina and posterior limb of internal capsule. And interesting point about reticular nucleus of thalamus is that it is the only nucleus of thalamus which does not send axons directly to the cortex. Other nuclei of thalamus, they directly send axons to the cortex. So the reticular nucleus is the only exception. So how this circuit works? So there is excitatory signals coming from cortical neurons in layer 6 that excites the reticular nucleus of thalamus. But the reticular nucleus of thalamus, it sends inhibitory signals to the relay neurons in the thalamus. And the relay neurons in the thalamus, they project back to cortex, but the projection is excitatory. So here the reticular nucleus of thalamus acts as a brake for the cortex. So this is a most schematic. This is a schematic diagram about a corticothalamic circuit. So there is excitation between cortex and reticular nucleus, as well as relay neurons in thalamus and cortex, and there is inhibition between the reticular nucleus and the relay neurons in thalamus. So same thing which I highlighted in the whatever I told, it's highlighted in the theory. So this cortical circuit is considered to play a major role in the pathophysiology of absence seizures. Just to revise again, some of the neurons involved in the corticothalamic cortical system include cortical glutamatergic neurons originating in the cortical layer 6, project to the nucleus reticularis of the thalamus. Thalamic relay neurons that have excitatory projections to the cortical pyramidal neurons. Third, neurons from the thalamic nucleus reticularis containing inhibitory GABA projections that connect with other neurons from the same nuclei and with the thalamic relay neurons. These neurons do not connect directly with the cortex. So coming next, there are different firing patterns of reticular nucleus. So that was the schematic diagram of the corticothalamic circuit. Now we'll see what are the firing patterns of reticular nucleus. See, it has two patterns. One is the tonic firing, and second is the oscillatory firing. That one, if it is firing tonically, then it causes wakefulness. And if it is firing in an oscillatory manner, it causes sleep spindles. And there is a switch happening between tonic firing and oscillatory firing. So what happens is that this is mediated by low threshold. T stands for transient calcium channel. So the switch is mediated by low threshold transient type of calcium channel. So this is where ethosuximide acts. So what happens in genetic absence epilepsies, there is defect in the calcium channel. That is, low threshold transient calcium channels are defective. So what happens, the switching between the tonic firing and the oscillatory firing is dysregulated. That causes absence seizures. And the mechanism of action of ethosuximide is, it acts on this, it inhibits this low threshold transient type of calcium channel. So same thing, whatever I told is explained in theory. Neurons from the thalamic nucleus reticularis can fire in an oscillatory pattern, for example rhythmic bursts involved in generation of sleep spindle, or continuously in single spikes, tonic firing during wakefulness. And the shifts between these firing patterns in the thalamic nucleus reticularis are modulated by spikes present in thalamocortical networks and neurons from the thalamic nucleus reticularis. These are mediated through low threshold transient calcium channels known as T-type channels. So basically, again, this is the how the ethosuximab attacks is the blockade of low threshold calcium currents is likely to be responsible for its efficacy in primary generalized absence type of epilepsy. Coming to the topic of dosing, the initial dose for patients 3 to 6 years of age is one capsule, that is 250 mg per day. And if the patient is 6 years of age or older, two capsules can be given, that is 500 mg per day. And the dose thereafter must be tailored according to the patient's response. And dosage should be increased by small increments so that the side effects, the benefit should be more than the side effects. So the dose for less than 6 years is one tablet and one capsule, and if it is more than 6 years, two capsules per day. And one useful method is to increase the daily dose by 250 mg every 4 to 7 days until control is achieved with minimal side effects. So 4 to 7 days, this period is chosen. Why? Because already we know that the steady state concentration of the drug is reached in 7 days. So at least we have to wait for at least minimum of 4 to 7 days to see whether the drug is effective or not before hiking the dose. And the optimal dose for most pediatric patients is 20 mg per kg per day. And the accepted therapeutic range of 40 to 100 mcg per ml. So coming to the missed doses. So the drug should be taken, the forgotten dose to be taken immediately. But if this is almost time for the next dose, wait for time for the next dose. And most importantly, do not take two doses closely together. This was a question in our pre-test. We'll come back to that. So these are three important points of missed doses. Do not take two doses closely together. That is the conclusion. Coming to the contraindication, in patients with a history of hypersensitivity to succinamides, this drug should not be given. Use in hepatic and renal dysfunction should be administered with extreme caution to patients with known liver or renal disease. Periodic urine analysis and liver function parameters are advised for all patients receiving the drug. Use in pregnancy, the drug crosses placenta, and cases of birth defects have been reported with ethosuximide. Mainly cleft lip and cleft palate is reported in literature. So the conclusion is to avoid the drug in pregnancy. Use in nursing mothers, the drug is excreted in human breast milk. As the effects of ethosuximide on the nursing infant are unknown, caution should be exercised when administered to a nursing mother, and should be used in nursing mothers only if the benefits clearly outweigh the risk. That is the statement made in literature. Coming to the pediatric use, the safety and effectiveness in pediatric patients below age of 3 years have not been established. So the FDA approval is only for absent seizures more than 3 years of age. Although the efficacy is present, but the safety of in pediatric patients less than 3 years is not established. Coming to the adverse reactions, it can cause anaphylactic reaction, body as a whole. And most important side effects are the gastrointestinal system, which can cause vague gastric upset, nausea, and vomiting. Hence, the drug should be taken with meals. Anorexia, cramps, epigastric and abdominal pain can cause weight loss, diarrhea. One of the drugs causing gum hypertrophy and swelling of the tongue, macrocrossia. And another important feature is its effect on hemopoietic system. It can cause leukopenia, agranulocytosis, pancytopenia with or without bone marrow suppression and eosinophilia. So this is an idiosyncratic reaction. This cannot be predicted. So, but can be prevented by monitoring regular blood counts. One, in the literature, they say that if the total counts, the total WBC count is going less than 3,500, then it is better to stop the drug. So these are the most important, most common side effects are gastrointestinal, most important side effect is from hematopoietic system can cause agranulocytosis. Patient can one should tell the patient if they develop sore throat, fever, then they should come immediately because of chances of infection due to agranulocytosis and leukopenia and pancytopenia. Bleeding can also happen because of thrombocytopenia. Coming to nervous system, it can cause drowsiness and other side effects like headache, dizziness, euphoria, hiccups, irritability, hyperactivity, fatigue and lethargy, ataxia, can cause disturbance in sleep, night terrors, and difficulty to concentrate and aggressiveness. And there have been reports, rare reports of paranoid psychosis, increased libido, and increased state of depression with overt suicidal intention. This is also a very important point. It can unmask depression, and in a patient who is depressed, can increase his depression levels and can cause suicidal intentions. So this is also a very important point to be noted with ethosuximide. Generally, it is applicable for all anti-epileptics, but special mention for this drug. Coming into integumentary system, urticaria, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, SLE, and pruritic erythematous rashes, hirsutism can be seen. It can cause rarely myopia, and vaginal bleeding and microscopic hematuria is due to thrombocytopenia. Coming to the topic of drug interactions, the clearance of the drug is increased in epileptic patients who are co-medicated with enzyme-inducing anticonvulsant drugs, which results in lower plasma levels of ethosuximide. So as we know, these are very common enzyme-inducing anti-epileptics are phenobarbital, phenytoin, carbamazepine. And interaction with other anti-epileptics, ethosuximide may elevate phenytoin serum levels. Phenytoin can decrease ethosuximide, but ethosuximide may elevate phenytoin levels. Valproic acid has been reported to both increase and decrease ethosuximide levels, but the mechanism for this is not known. Coming to anti-tubercular drugs, isoniazid may precipitate ethosuximide toxicity through inhibition of metabolism. Rifampicin decreases plasma levels due to increased ethosuximide clearance. So isoniazid causes toxicity. How to remember is it starts isoniazid starts with isoniazid, so ethosuximide also starts with E, so both can cause toxicity. So that is a mnemonic to be remembered. Ethosuximide does not interact significantly with oral contraceptives, but however, the precaution should be taken in a young female patients. Coming to the overdose, acute overdoses may produce nausea, vomiting, and CNS depression, including coma with respiratory depression. However, a relationship between ethosuximide toxicity and plasma levels has not been established. Treatment of overdose includes emesis or gastric lavage, use of activated charcoal, and other general supportive measures. Hemodialysis may be useful to treat ethosuximide overdose. As we know, it was in the pharmacokinetics, it is not bound to plasma proteins. So this feature is utilized in treatment of overdose. Hemodialysis may be useful. Coming to what are the precautions to be taken while using this drug? The drug may increase the frequency of generalized tonic-clonic seizures in some patients when used alone in mixed type of epilepsy. So the point is that it should not be used as a monotherapy in generalized tonic-clonic seizures. It's a drug of choice of monotherapy for generalized absence seizures. But it can also be combined with other anti-epileptics to treat absence seizures. It is important to proceed slowly when increasing or decreasing dosage, as well as when adding or eliminating other medications. And as with any other anti-epileptic, abrupt withdrawal of anticonvulsant medication may precipitate status epilepticus, in this case, absence status. So what information to be provided to the patients on ethosuximide? The drug may impair the mental and or physical abilities required for the performance of potentially hazardous tasks such as driving a motor vehicle or any other such activity requiring alertness. Hence, the patient should be cautioned accordingly. And the patient should be advised of the importance of adhering strictly to the prescribed dosage regimen. Importantly, to promptly contact the physician if they develop signs and or symptoms suggesting an infection like sore throat and fever, as it can cause agranulocytosis, pancytopenia, but it cannot be prevented as it is an idiosyncratic reaction. One should be careful if the total WBC count is going less than 3500. So periodic monitoring is needed. So may increase the risk of suicidal thoughts and behavior, and should be advised of the need to be alert for the emergence or worsening of symptoms of depression and any unusual changes in mood or behavior, or the emergence of suicidal thoughts, behavior, and thoughts about self-harm. And the behaviors of concern should be reported immediately to the healthcare providers. Okay, so coming to the, this is about the topic. So coming to the pretest, so we'll discuss about the questions now. So question was, all of the following of true of ethosuximide except. So A, can be used in atypical absence seizures. That is true. It can be used in atypical absence seizures. As we know, what is the definition of atypical absence seizures? It is seen in the syndromes like Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. It can be used. So the statement is true. So can be combined with other anti-epileptics in refractory absence seizures. This statement is also true because it can be combined with other anti-epileptics. What are the other anti-epileptics used in absence seizures? That is, one is, three drugs are effective in absence seizures. One is ethosuximide, second is valproate, third is lamotrigine. So the side effect, third thing is that valproate and the ethosuximide efficacy is almost same, but the side effects of valproate compared to ethosuximide is more. The efficacy and the side effect profile of lamotrigine is worse than valproate. So the option B is also true, can be combined with other anti-epileptics in refractory absence seizures. Option C is, can be safely used in typical absence seizures in children of all ages. So this statement, you have to, every point, the word is important, can be safely used, the word is safely used in typical absence seizures. Okay, if the, it can be used in typical absence seizures safely, but what is the age which the FDA has approved is more than 3 years of age. The safety profile in less than 3 years of age is not known. So the option C seems false. Option D, side effect profile is better compared to other drugs used in absence seizures. So that is why this is a drug of choice for monotherapy of treatment of absence seizures. So the answer is C, can be safely used in atypical absence seizures in children of all ages. If the problem statement is children of all ages, less than 3 years, safety is not known. Coming to the second question, we'll read that 7 year child has typical absence seizures. Ethosuximide 200 mg BD was prescribed. Dosing schedule was morning 9 a.m. and night 8 p.m. At 6:30 p.m., parents realized the morning dose was skipped. What is the next plus plan? So already we know that it should not dosing should not be closely together. So that is the point we have to see. And if the time is like the next, if the time is near to the next dose, then you have to give the dose at the next time only. So these two points are used to answer this question. So second, the option A, take both doses together at 8 p.m. No, it is false because we should not give 500 mg in as a single dose. It will cause the gastric upset, nausea, vomiting. So this option is wrong. So take one dose at 8 p.m. This is the right answer because at 6:30 p.m. is all close to almost 8 p.m. 1.5 hours time is remaining. You can give one dose here. Option C, why it is wrong, is take forgotten dose immediately and second dose at 8 p.m. Again, because the dosing is, the two doses will be very close together. So this is again a wrong option. D, take both doses immediately. Again, it is a wrong option because both the doses should not be given. So the best answer is, the best plan is to take one dose at 8 p.m. This is a summary chart of the drug. That's it from my side. If anything, this topic is open for discussion. Thank you for your patient listening, and thanks, Sharma sir, for providing me an opportunity to present this topic.
Thank you, Dr. Sagar. It was very nice, especially the concept of generation of absence centers, as well as neurotransmitters. Very nicely provided.
Thank
you. Summary.
Thanks.
Three slides you have summarized it very well. I hope the students have understood this concept. I think we have two critical points that we can discuss. As you rightly said, it is approved only for absence seizures, but it also works for myoclonia, both positive and negative myoclonus.
Yes.
If the patient has a drop attack with myoclonus, negative myoclonus, you can still use it as an off-label. So there is a good thing. You can worse than generalized myoclonus seizure, but for myoclonus, it helps.
Yes.
One point to be remembered. Next point is, there is a Cochrane review in 2017 comparing the three drugs because of SNIDE, Valproate, and Amitriptyline for absence epilepsy.
Yes,
and they came up with the data which you have said that both are equally effective because of SNIDE and Valproate. But Valproate gave more attentional deficit problems. Almost 50% in Valproate group had attention problems, whereas only 30% in because of SNIDE had attention. Even that is high figure, 30%. That is less than Valproate. And that is why it is a Lamotrigine efficacy is only 30% compared to the other two which have almost 55-60% efficacy. So that is why it stands. So third drug of choice would be Lamotrigine. And in some papers, clobazam is recommended. But we have remembered that benzodiazepines can precipitate absence seizures and even absence status epilepticus. That is because they cause hypersynchronization, which is a trigger for the E-type calcium seizures. So better to avoid benzodiazepines, phenytoin, carbamazepine, ergagabine. These can worsen the absence of seizures. So that's another point to remember.
Yes.
Anything else? We have covered everything else.
So, Dr. Sagar, nice presentation. See,
yes.
Combining both valproate and ethosuximide, no? See, right now I have one child, classical absence. She is now nine years of age. Started ethosuximide, and initially it was not coming under control, so a low dose of valproate was added. So excellently it was controlled till last 2 months. So one episode of GT, now she is in 11 and a half years. The GTCS has come, so it was not there. So now, it is not like a congenital childhood absence epilepsy. It looks like more of a JME, like myoclonic jerks are there. So now, should we continue or only add valproate plus levetiracetam, take off ethosuximide?
Yes, sir.
So,
I think valproate has action on both absence as well as generalized tonic clonic. So if that, I think. I'm not sure, but I think we can take off ethosuximide, valproate, and levetiracetam can be given.
So actually, initially EEG was classical 3 hertz spike and wave. So now this time EEG is showing polyspikes. In absence alone, I don't think polyspikes will come. No, sir, it is more of a suggestive of a JME spectrum.
You see polyspikes, no? That is it. Indicator for poor response to
ethosuximide. So, yes. So this was not there. In the first EEG, it was not there. So
right now, the age has advanced.
Yes. So the
another symptom.
So fair
to add
the first
or
the
rest, and then
take off. So as Dr. That's it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
SLE is an important side effect, just like phenytoin, carbamazepine. masculine or girl, gum hypertrophic, all these things which are common to other drugs. Dyskinesias have been reported, extrapyramidal reaction, dyskinesias, which respond to inner gland, that has been reported. And another important hypertrophy is night terrors. I don't know whether I missed the fact. Night terrors are reported in this drug, so we should be aware of that. But then the typing will cover it most of the time. Let's see if any other questions are there, remarks are there. Till next time. Thank you.